Hopefully you've made your way to Luke chapter 11. We've been working our way through the Gospel of Luke in our weekend services. And 2 weeks ago, we began Luke chapter 11, and we began talking about praying the Lord's Prayer. Some of us come from a background where it's called the Our Father. And as I've said each week, there's so much more than can be said on Sunday morning. If you want to go further on this, the best book I've ever read on this subject is by Elmer Townsend. It's called Praying the Lord's Prayer, Praying the Lord's Prayer for Spiritual Breakthrough. So this morning at the 8:30 service, a lady in our church, her name is Joan Sorensen, she comes up to me. She says, "You keep mentioning this book every week. You're mentioning the book." She goes, "Finally," I said, "I'm going to get the book." So she got the book. She goes, "I love it." And I want you to know that if you get this book, you will absolutely love this book, and it will change your prayer life and probably change your entire, if you change your prayer life, it's going to change your entire life. So anyways, moving on, we've been looking at this over the last couple of weeks through the lens of how they would have understood this 2,000 years ago. Now, what I've said each week is that I'm taking this from the King James Version, and the reason for that is some of the other versions will leave out words and phrases that the King James leaves in there. So I'm going to read it again today, and then we'll begin to unpack it. So there on your outline from the King James, it says, "And it came to pass as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples," now keep in mind, we'll talk about this more next week, but this is something that he's speaking to disciples. The crowd is not there. "One of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray as John also taught his disciples. And he said to them, when you pray, say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so in earth." And then everybody underline this next phrase, "Give us day by day our daily bread." Then it goes on and it says, "And forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." So as we said the last couple of weeks, many of us grew up being taught that this is a prayer that you pray. And the reality is that even if you pray this slowly, it only takes about 10 seconds. So many of us have been taught that it's a prayer that you pray, but the disciples understood it a little bit differently. And so I want you to write this down one more time. They would understand that Jesus taught this as an outline for prayer. So it's not so much a prayer, it's an outline for prayer. What I'm sharing with you is commonly understood in theological circles, but it's not always commonly taught in church. Now, I love one line of it, which is more of a modern translation. It says, "So Jesus told them, pray then in this way." And so the idea is this is how you want to be praying, not so much that it's a prayer. If you pray it as a prayer, that's fine. It's not wrong. I'm just articulating from another viewpoint. Now, if you want to track that down a little bit more, it's all online. We have that from the last couple of weeks. But here's what we did. We walked through this and we talked about, first of all, you have the approach in prayer, Our Father who is in heaven. And we talked about how the God of heaven wants to be a father to me, and he wants to be a father to you, and that is the relationship that he wants to have. We also talked about when he says, Our Father, Jesus is including himself. The reason he says, Our Father, is because we are going to the Father with Jesus, which is why, regardless of your church background, whether you called it the Lord's Prayer or the Our Father, no one ever prays this and at the end of it says, in Jesus' name, because you're actually going to the Father with Jesus. And then we talked about the first petition, and the first petition was, hallowed be thy name. And we talked about how we amplify the names of God. And these are Jewish disciples, and they understood from the Old Testament that God had certain names which identified not just his name, but who he was. And so we gave you an outline. I think we gave that out today also. It's in your program. My favorite one is the first one. It's called El Shaddai. Some would say El Shaddai. Either way, and it just means the Lord God Almighty. And when I begin in my prayer time thinking about that the one who wants to be a father to me, he also happens to be the Lord God Almighty. That begins to change how I view my circumstance and who I have backing me up when I face those circumstances. That's why we begin by looking at his names. It's who he is. Well, then we talked about the second petition, which is thy kingdom come. And that's where we begin to pray about the things that are important to God. And the things that are important to God, we pray about before we pray about the things that are important to us. What's important to God? Well, the gospel going forward, people coming into God's kingdom, lives being changed, you know, all that, that's important to God. We start there. Thy kingdom come. Then we went to the third petition last week, which was thy will be done as in heaven, so in earth. And we mentioned that God has a will and he wants us to know his will. Last week we looked at four filters that we can look at so that we can understand God's will. And then the final filter was what he says there, thy will be done as in heaven, so in earth. So we looked at that and we said, so what is God's will in heaven? And we said, well, does everybody in heaven, is anybody lacking in heaven? Or does everybody have all they need? All they need. Is anybody sick in heaven? No, everybody's well. Anybody having relationship problems in heaven? No, everything's good there. So he says there, thy will be done as in heaven, so in earth. The idea is we pray what God's will is there to happen here, because that's really what he wants to see take place. So we talked about that last week. Now today, we're going to look at the fourth petition. And as we get into this, I have to tell you that the first week I said we were going to do this in 2 weeks. And then last week, I realized that it was going to take 3 weeks, but only 3 weeks. And I've totally lied to you. But I promise you that next week will be the last week. I promise. So, but today as we look at the fourth petition, I want to begin with a verse, just kind of set this up and give us some understanding. In Psalm 37, it says this. It says, delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. Now, when it says that he will give you the desires of your heart, it doesn't mean that he fulfills the desires of your heart. What he's saying is as we spend time with him, delighting ourselves, as we pray in this way, we're delighting ourselves in him. That's where he begins to give us the desires that he wants us to have, and he puts those desires in our heart. Doesn't say that he fulfills them, he gives us the desires. So as I spend time with him, it causes me to have the desire to be a good dad, to be a good husband, and to be a good pastor. Now, I don't always do that, but the desire is there. And wouldn't you agree that we live in a world where sadly not everybody has a desire to be a good dad, to be a good husband? But when you spend time with him, delighting yourself in him, he begins to put the desires that he has for you inside of you. So as I spend that time, that desire gets stronger. Now, as we get into this today, we're going to talk about the desires that God is giving us. We're not talking about desires apart from him. So you want to keep that in mind as we go. So here's the fourth petition there on your outline. It's give us day by day our daily bread. Give us day by day our daily bread. Now, I've mentioned Elmer Towns' book, and what Elmer Towns does so brilliantly, when we think of bread, give us day by day our daily bread, we tend to think of food and, you know, just enough for today. But that's how we might understand it as Westerners 2,000 years removed. But in their culture and their language, they understood it slightly differently. So Elmer Towns does a great job explaining how they would understand it, but then putting it into our context. So I'm going to read one paragraph to kind of put this in perspective. He says, bread stands for more than food. It stands for the results we get from eating food. It stands for all the physical things we need in life. Bread is a symbol word that stands for money, for time, for a job, for material things. Bread stands for the roof over our heads and the clothes on our back. It stands for a car to give us basic transportation or subway money to get us to work. Bread stands for fuel oil in the winter for air conditioning in the summer, for physical healing so we can work, and for a raise so we can properly support our families. Bread stands for every physical need in our lives. It stands for everything that we need to live life effectively. So when you think of this, we tend to think of this like you get what you need every single day, but that's not what's really being conveyed here. So if you have gas, you put gas in your car. Most of us, we put gas in our car like at the beginning of the week or sometime during the week, and then we drive it all week. It's not that we get enough gas just for today, but it's something that we use on a daily basis. Would that make sense to you? So it's more than just what I'm using today, that's what I'm praying for. But it doesn't mean you're just gonna get enough for today. So hopefully that makes sense. So I want you to write this down. The first thing we're gonna write down is that when I pray, give us day by day our daily bread, write this down, that God designed us to have daily needs. God designed us to have daily needs. God designed us, made us so that we would have daily needs or our needs that we would go to him to supply them. And so we look to him on a daily basis. One of the reasons that we need to have a daily time of prayer is we want to be praying this on a daily basis. Doesn't mean he's just going to give you enough for today, but you want to be going to him on a daily basis. So he apparently wants us to ask him to supply our needs. Go ahead and write this down. Experiencing God supplying our needs builds trust. You could also say faith. Either way. In the same way, when our children, and parents, you know this, when our children experience us providing their needs physically and emotionally, it builds their trust in us. And also, when we do that, we meet their needs emotionally, we meet their needs materially, it builds a deep sense of security in the relationship. And some of us come from a background where that wasn't done, and there was an insecurity in the relationship. Here he wants us to have a deeply secure relationship. So as we delight ourselves in the Lord, our desires, those things that he wants us to have that come from him, he wants to meet those things. I would hold that God doesn't just want to meet the things that we need just to exist. If we're delighting ourselves in him, he's giving us the desires that he has for us, the things that we desire, the things that we want. So for instance, in my family, years ago when Cheryl and I were, and even now today, Cheryl would come out and she'd just look at my nails, look at my toes and my nails. And I had the wisdom to say, we can't have that. You need to go to that nail repair shop that you go to and you need to take care of that. And I love her face as she's heading out the door, and usually several of my daughters are in tow as they're going. They're all gonna go get their nails done. Now, here's the thing. That's not life or death. You can live without getting your nails done, but God delights that she can go and do that. So those are those desires that as God has placed in her heart. Hasn't placed that in my heart. I don't want to get my nails done. So God wants to supply many of our wants too. And if we're delighting him, those wants are actually coming from the Lord. Also very important, write this down. I'm not just asking God to get stuff. I'm asking God to show his greatness through supplying my needs. I believe that God wants us to have some awesome God stories. Many of us come from a church background where he was the God of just barely enough. But you don't get that from your Bible. When Jesus fed the 5,000, when you read the story, you find that Jesus starts with two fish, five pieces of bread, and he feeds the 5,000. It's more like 15,000 or more. And everybody is stuffed. Everybody is stuffed. And not only are they stuffed, but there's 12 baskets left over because he's the God of abundance, not the God of barely enough. But one of the great things about that story is you can bet nobody who was there on that day ever forgot that took place. And they had an incredible God story that they could share with the people that they knew. So partly, God loves to supply our needs in a way so that our unbelieving friends can look on and say, really, your God did that for you? I want to hear more about that God. But if your great God stories are, yes, we had just enough, just barely enough. And then this happened, we had just barely enough. Your unbelieving friends are going to look on, they're going to go, I can do that on my own. So he loves to supply needs in a way that causes him to look great. And our unbelieving friends look on and say, I want to hear more about this God. Now, you know this because you're created in the image of God. We talked about this last week. There's so much that we can learn about God by looking at ourselves. We're unique in the creation in that we are created in his image. So when we look at our children, last week we asked the question, do I want my children to have not enough? Do I want them to have just barely enough? Or do I want them to have all they need? Well, if you're a halfway decent parent, you'd say, I want them to have all that they need. Whatever they need, I want them to have. You get that because you are created in the image of God. The rest of the creation, the rest of the all the living things, they don't think in those terms. They're not created in the image of God. So God delights in doing things in a way that causes us to say, and I'm going to share with you a verse. We would have never read this verse in the church that I grew up in, but there in your outline, Psalm 35:27, it says, and they may say continually, the Lord be exalted who delights in the prosperity of his servant. God wants to supply your needs in a way that reveals how great he is and causes us to say, wow, you really do care about me. You really do want to see me win, prosper, however you would want to say that. But that's how he wants to supply our needs. So go ahead and write this down. God loves to abundantly supply what we need to accomplish his purpose for our lives. And he wants to do that abundantly. We all know this story where Jesus goes to the wedding. There's probably 100 people there. They run out of wine. You know the story. He says, fill the pots. And you study the archaeology. Those pots are about 30 gallons each. There's 6 of them. So for this party, when Jesus turns the water into wine, he creates minimally 180 gallons of wine. That's abundant. That's a lot of wine, especially for you know, the small wedding that they had. So God wants us to take our needs to him so that he can supply them, not just barely enough, but abundantly. So we're not just asking God to get stuff. We're asking God to, I would say, glorify himself through the supplying of our needs, in such a way that our non-believing friends can look on and say, there must be something about your God. I want to hear more about that God. Now, having said that, let me say this over here. Next verse on your outline. Here's what Paul writes to Timothy, and he says, but godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. One of the mistakes that we make as believers is we compare God's provision in our life with God's provision in somebody else's life. And we say, God, why aren't you providing for me like you are for that person who lives in that more expensive neighborhood, that more expensive car and you know, much bigger house and all that? Well, just know that that person in that neighborhood, they're looking at the next neighborhood up and they're going, God, why aren't you providing for me? Like, and it never ends. But here's the thing. You never want to compare God's provision in your life with God's provision in someone else's life, because that's coveting and you don't want to do that. That's where you go into sin. So always remember, if you have a house, you have a condo, an apartment, you're not living under a bridge, you have indoor plumbing, you have a refrigerator, you have a car, you know, you're doing well. I've been to Haiti, I've been to the mountains in Haiti, and I've seen the people who have no concept of electricity, running water, they have none of that. So compared to much of the world, even though you might not feel blessed, you are living like a king from their perspective. And so you always want to keep that in mind when you're thinking of God's provision. So I would suggest you always want to begin by thanking God for how he has blessed you. And then as you did, I'm sure God will want to bless you more. But compared to the rest of the world, we are very blessed. Now, when we pray, God, give us our daily needs. We are expressing our ultimate confidence in Him in meeting our needs. So I wanted to say that today, but there's another part of this that I really want to talk about. And it's like, okay, if God likes to provide my needs abundantly, and that's true, and you see the stories, feeding the 5,000 and turning the water into wine, and all the miracles, why are my needs not being met? And so I wanted to take a few minutes and just talk about there on your outline when provision isn't there. And I'm going to give you three thoughts to consider this week. And if provision isn't there, the first thing that you want to look at, and you want to write this down, would be first to remove ongoing sin. Remove ongoing sin. Now, I do not believe that you have to do an exhaustive search to find your ongoing sin. Anytime I've been in sin, the Holy Spirit is letting me know, I know when I'm in sin. And so do you. So do you. Oh, I'm alone in this? So we know. I mean, like the Holy Spirit's in me, He's in you. When I'm in sin, He's talking, right? I'm hearing it. I'm hearing it. So it's not like I have to do this exhaustive, you know, search. He lets me know. He lets me know. But sin has a way in the Bible of blocking our prayers. So I could give you 100 different verses. I'm just going to give you one. There in your outline, Peter writes it like this. Now keep in mind, this is the Middle East 2,000 years ago. You husbands, in the same way, live with your wives in an understanding way as with someone weaker, since she is a woman, and show her honor as a fellow heir of grace of life, so that, underline, that your prayers will not be hindered. Now keep in mind, this is the Middle East 2,000 years ago. You've heard the phrase that a woman's work is never done. It's nothing compared to the way it was 2,000 years ago, because women were not honored typically. It wasn't until Jesus came along and said, we're going to do things very differently. Peter says, not only are we going to do them differently, but she's a fellow heir with you in this salvation. So you're going to treat her as an equal. She's going to be right there alongside of you. So guys, you might look at your wife and go, well, that's my wife and this, that, and the other thing. Just remember, to you, she's your wife, but to God, she's His little girl. And the truth is, and I have 5 daughters, one is married, 2 are getting married here in the next month or so. What I've learned, and we're very thankful for the guys that they're married and are marrying. It's been great. But dads, wouldn't you agree, somebody does something to your little girl and it just does something on the inside of you, and I am alone in this, aren't I? Yeah. So we feel that way. We feel that way about our little girls. And so you might think, well, she's my wife. God said, no. That's my little girl. And you better be very careful how you treat her. Because if you don't treat her right, you can pray all day. It's like talking to the wall, because I ain't listening. And I'm not blessing that. Now, one other thing I'm going to say, then I'm going to move on, is that ladies, he might be your annoying husband, but to God, he's His little boy. So I threw that in there just for free. It doesn't say that, but all right, so that's the first thing, ongoing sin. Now here's the second thing. And I so wish growing up in prayer, growing up in church, somebody would have explained this next part to me. So Peter says this, you want to underline as we go. He says, for His divine power has granted to us everything, or all things, if you have a literal translation, pertaining to life. Granted everything, all things pertaining to life and godliness through the true knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and excellence. Through these, He has granted to us His precious and magnificent promises, so that by them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world on account of lust. Now, there's so much in that passage. I can't talk about all of it. I want to highlight just a couple of things, hopefully to expand or change our paradigm. First of all, we underlined the word granted. We underlined it 2 times. Did everybody see that? Did you notice that the word granted is in the past tense? It's in the past tense. He's already granted it. He's already said yes to it, is the idea. He's already said yes to all things that pertain to life. And then we say in godliness. But he's already said yes. He's already said yes. So if he has granted all things that pertain to life, I don't need to spend a great deal of time asking him to grant what he's already said, I've already granted. I've already done my part. It's granted. So the idea is he's not the one saying no, because he's already granted it. So for the promises, it's not that he hasn't granted them, but we have to begin to operate in them in faith. So he says, I've given you all things that pertain to life. I've already granted all things that pertain to life. So let me ask you a question. Does the money that your bills, does that pertain to life? Try living without it for a month. You'll see it's up there on the priority that yes, it pertains to life. He knows that he's already said yes. He's not the one saying no to that. All right, so a little bit more. We'll go a little bit further. What about a reliable car in this area? Would you say that pertains to life? Yes. So, I mean, he's not the one saying no. He's already granted. That's fine. What about a place to live, a safe place to live? Would that pertain to life? Okay, so he says, I've already granted. I'm not holding you back on that. So I've already said yes. So if those things that he says he's already granted and those things aren't happening, it's not that he hasn't granted them. I need to begin by saying, Lord, you've already said yes to these things. So you're not the one holding me back if God's already granted all things that pertain to life. And it's not happening, then what do I do? Well, I want to give you an illustration that Jesus gives, maybe from a slightly different perspective than you've heard before. Some of you have heard some of this, but there in your outline, if it's not happened and Jesus says, I've already granted it. There in your outline, it says, Jesus is speaking, says, look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Now, I would say if we're not careful, we can read this in a slightly wrong way, and I hope to clarify some things as we go. But the reality is here we find God feeds the birds of the air, which is why you have never seen a starving bird. You've never seen a starving bird. Because God has provided all that the bird needs. We would say he has granted all things that the bird needs. He's already provided it. It's there. But here's the follow-up question. He's granted it. He's provided it. I would suggest to you he's willed it. But does God drop the worm or the berries off at the nest? The answer would be no. He doesn't drop it off at the nest. So God's part would be to grant it, to provide all that the bird needs. There's an abundance of it. But the bird's part is the bird's going to have to get up, get going, and keep going until the bird gets what he needs, because God's not dropping it off at the nest. He's provided it, but he's not dropping it off. So if the bird sits in the nest and says, I'm just trusting God for the food he provides for the birds, what do you think is going to happen to the bird? He's going to die ultimately. Hopefully he gets motivated at some point, but you know, the ultimate end of that is it doesn't work out because God provides it, but he's not dropping it off. So there's this partnership between God and the bird. God says, I've provided it, I've granted it, but you've got to go get it. And I think God is even saying, I'll even go with you to go get it. I'll go with you to go get it. So for us, God has granted all things that pertain to life. He's not the one who's holding back. He's not the one. But like the bird's going to have to get up, get going, and get out of the nest. So in the same for us. So the promise here is that God has granted it, and that part is true. But we have to be very careful of saying, well, I'm just waiting on God. Well, there's a time for that. But many times God's saying, no, I provided it, but you're going to have to get up, get going, and go get it, because he's not dropping it off at the nest. Does that make sense to you? Okay. So if I need something and God has granted it pertaining to life and I don't have it, a good question for me to ask, and please write this down, is what's my part? Is there something that I need to do? for the bird, even though God has granted it, he's provided it, and I would suggest even willed it, he still has to get going. Because for the bird, God's provision requires action, and I'm going to suggest that it also requires some skills. You see, the action that the bird has to take has to be purposeful, goal-oriented. If the bird just gets up and flies around in circles, that does not help the bird. He's got to be going towards his goal to get what he needs that God has provided. Also, I'm going to suggest some skills. If the bird doesn't know how to hunt, doesn't know where to find the worm or the berries, even though God has provided it, it's not going to help the bird. So he's going to have some skills and some action that go with it. So it's the same thing with us. One of my mentors says, you can't live a $1 million life with minimum wage thinking. And the truth is, for so many, we want more, but we have to change our thinking. And I would suggest to earn more, we have to learn more. And so it's not that God hasn't provided it, it's just there might be some steps that we need to take along the way. Does that make sense to you? So if I were to come to you today and say, I'm Dan, I'm a farmer, I want you to call me Farmer Dan. And here's the thing, I believe in God, I believe in miracles, I believe in promises. So here's what I'm believing for this year. I'm believing for the greatest crop I have ever had in my whole life. I'm just trusting God for the greatest crop ever. It's gonna be great. Now, if I'm believing God for the harvest, this great crop, do I believe God, or would you say, well, I should probably plant some seed? Okay, so if I'm believing God for this great harvest, should I plant some seed? Should I plant a little more seed? Or should I plant a whole bunch of seed? Whole bunch of seed, okay, because I'm believing God. So it's more than just saying I'm believing in God, I'm taking some steps along the way. Well, if I'm believing God for this great harvest and I planted some seeds, do you think maybe I should water the crop? Or do I just trust and say, you know, God's gonna take care of it? Should I fertilize the crop? Depending on your opinion on fertilizer. Okay, my crop is organic. Okay, we'll go with that. So, all right. So I'm believing God, but I'm taking some steps along the way. So it's not that God is holding it back, but I need to take some steps. So that's the action side. Now here's the skill side. What you might not know about farming is that there are different types of soil that different types of crops grow in. So some crops you can plant in some soil and they don't do well at all. So as a farmer, should I know what's the best soil to plant my seed in? Absolutely. So that's going to enhance the crop. So God's not holding it back, but I need to know that. You might not know this, but there are some seed that if you plant too deep, it will destroy the seed. And other seed, if you plant too shallow, it will destroy the seed. So as a farmer, would you say that I should probably know not just the soil, but the depth of how deep I plant the seed? Absolutely. All that goes into it. And when all that goes in, then I can believe God to do his part, but he's expecting me to understand my part. Let me just share with you a verse. I love this verse. We're going to see it's our part and God's part. He says there in Deuteronomy 28, he says, the Lord will command the blessing for you in your barns and in everything you put your hand to. God says, I'll bless it. Everything you put your hand to, he will bless you in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. So God says, I'm going to bless what you do, but you got to put your hand to it. It's not just going to show up. And so for so many in church world, they're waiting for it to show up and they never put their hand to it. I'm gonna tell you a very quick personal story. Prior to going to Calvary, Fort Lauderdale, going on staff there, the Lord had me in a season where I was in sales. Now, I was very frustrating to my manager because I had a college degree, I had a master's degree, I'd completed all the coursework from my second master's degree, and I'm working in the sales organization. Most of the other guys there, they maybe completed high school, and I was the lowest producer in the whole sales organization. They were high producers, they would get paid and go smoke crack, which I did not do, by the way, just to clarify. So I'm, and my manager would say, what is with you? You know, you present, you know, you can talk, you know, and that you're, but they're making money and you're not. I was literally the lowest person on the totem pole in the sales force. Well, I'm going along this way, and a friend of mine, he owned a commodities brokerage firm, and after some years, he decided to get out of that. He was a CPA, and so he went and he took a job with the SEC. And he comes to me with this box of tapes, and he hands me the tapes. He goes, if you're gonna be in sales, you need to listen to these tapes. And I'm like, I don't need to listen to these tapes. I'm not gonna listen to the boring stuff and all that. So I wouldn't listen. But I finally got desperate, so hungry, that I was willing to try anything. And so one day, I decided to put a tape in. And that was by a guy named Brian Tracy. How many of you know Brian Tracy? Brian Tracy has changed my life. And if you want to change your life, look up Brian Tracy, the 1000% formula. If you practice that, your life will be dramatically different over time. So I began listening to this, and I realized he knows something, and I'm going to listen to him, and I'm going to glean from him. My income tripled in 3 weeks. I went from being the lowest producer to one of the highest producers in 3 weeks. The only thing that changed was skills and knowledge. God had already granted, he didn't have to do anything, but I had to put my hand to it in order to get the results that I wanted. Does that make sense to you? And so that, and I still listen to Brian Tracy, by the way, even today. But God didn't change. What changed was me, my skill set, and then things began to change. So write this down. What actions do I need to take, and what skills do I need to develop to receive all that God has granted? All that God has granted. So if I'm doing that, you know, I'm going to see some incredible results when I begin to do that. But then some people will say, and this is big for us as Christians, will say, you know, but I'm just not making it financially. I just, you know, it doesn't seem to be working. And this is a big one for many within the church at large. In the Old Testament, I'm not going to go through all the verses, by the way, on the outline, but God made a deal with his people in the Old Testament, and he said, listen, I'm going to provide for you. I'm going to bless you. I'm going to bless your lives. I'm going to command my blessing upon you. But here's the thing. I want you to put me first in your finances. And so they did. But over time, what took place is they began to back away from putting God first in their finances. And then it got to the place to where not only did they not put God first in their finances, they then began to take 100% of everything that God had provided for them, and they spent it all on themselves. And they left God completely out of the equation. And over time, they began to sense that they were not walking in God's blessing financially. Now, it wasn't that God struck them with lightning. He didn't knock down their house. He didn't make them homeless. He didn't make them live under a bridge. They just found that it just wasn't how it was used to be. So what I wanted to do is just show you today just one verse and how God describes this. That is such a good-looking pastor. Do you know how blessed you are? Thank you for that amen over there. All right. So through the prophet Haggai, he says this. Then the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai. Someone say Haggai. Is it a time for you yourselves to be living in your paneled houses while this house remains a ruin? They were taking care of their stuff, but they let God's stuff kind of go by the wayside. Now, this is what the Lord Almighty says. Give careful thought to your ways. You have planted much, but you've harvested little. You eat, but you never have enough. You drink, but you never have your fill. You put on clothes, but you're not warm. You earn wages only to put them in a purse with holes in it. Have you ever felt like you had a purse with holes in it? We've all been there. He says, this is what the Lord Almighty says. Don't you love that he says, this is who's talking to you, the Lord Almighty. I can do anything. He says, Almighty says, give careful thought to your ways. Go up to the mountains and bring down timber. It was very expensive. And build my house so that I may take pleasure in it and be honored. Now, this is an excerpt. I've actually condensed it to make the point. Read the expanded version later. But God goes on to say, the solution to receiving God's blessing in your life is to go ahead and put him in the first place in your finances. Now, as a Christian, God loves you. He will not love you more or less if you put him first in your finances or you don't. But here's the thing. Stinginess towards God does not lead to generosity from God. And so if that's you and you're wondering, why am I not experiencing God's blessing in my finances? It just feels like it's just going right through me. There never seems to be enough. Then I want you to write this down. If there's lack financially, simply ask the question or say, I need to put God first in my finances. Put God first in my finances. And if you don't, just know God loves you. That never changes. But you might not be experiencing the tangible blessings that God has for you, because that's how he gets involved in our financial picture. Well, with that, did you find that helpful today? Good. So we'll pick it up there next week and finish this part of the Lord's Prayer, and we really will be done, I promise. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this congregation, their love for you, their love for the things of God, your word, your spirit. And Lord, we pray that we take these things, we evaluate, and Lord, we realize that you're not holding anything back from us. You've already granted it. So Lord, show us what are the barriers that are in our life so that we can take action and get things going. Lord, thank you for this congregation. Keep us till we meet again. It's in Jesus' name that we pray, and all God's people said, amen. God bless you guys. We love you. We'll see you.